Right, let's kick off this deep dive. For what, the last decade? The whole mandate in AI has been pretty simple,
That
right?
bigger is better.
Exactly. More data, more compute. That's the path to better outcomes.
And, that entire approach has basically hit a wall.
Oh.
Two walls, actually. First, there's a huge efficiency crisis. I mean, the resources we're pouring in are just not sustainable.
Right.
But maybe even more worrying is the semantic crisis. These huge models, they're incredible simulators, but they don't actually understand anything. They're semantically hollow.
Okay, semantically hollow. Let's unpack that. So today we're diving into this idea of structural intelligence. The argument being that a structure, not scale, is the way forward.
That's it. We're looking at two really groundbreaking frameworks, one for the efficiency problem and another for the meaning problem.
So our mission today is to sort of find the blueprint for what comes next, an AI that's not just big, but efficient, certain, and, well, trustworthy. So let's start with efficiency. You mentioned a framework from MIT. What's the core question they're trying to answer?
They are asking something so fundamental. They're asking, what is the absolute bare minimum amount of data you need to solve a problem perfectly?
Perfectly. Not just, probably the best answer.
No, that's the huge shift. Traditional AI gives you a probabilistic assurance. It's likely the best. This new method, it uses structural knowledge to give you an optimality guarantee,
A mathematical certainty.
a mathematical certainty. It says this solution is the cheapest, period.
Okay, that's a massive claim. So how, you mentioned structural knowledge. I read about something called optimality cones.
Yes, and that's the key. It's really all about geometry. Imagine all your possible solutions are spread out, and you use polyhedral theory to divide this space into different cones.
Cones, like literal geometric shapes.
Exactly. Each cone represents one specific optimal strategy. So data collection is no longer about sampling everything. It's about finding boundaries.
Boundary resolute.
Right. You only collect the absolute minimum data you need to figure out which cone the true answer lies in.
Okay, so ground this for me. Let's say you're planning a new subway line.
Perfect example. Instead of doing expensive field studies all over the city, the algorithm tells you the very specific minimum number of places you need to measure to guarantee you find the cheapest possible route.
Which is a huge win for green AI, just right off the bat.
It is. But that savings isn't free. The catch is that the upfront modeling, defining those cones, is much more mathematically intense.
So more thinking up front, way less data collection later.
That's the trade-off.
Fascinating. Okay, so that's the efficiency crisis. But let's pivot to the deeper one, the meaning problem. Tell me about this Odam Tili theory.
Right, from Dr. Mamoudzhan Kuchkarov. This challenges everything we thought we knew about language. For centuries, the core belief in linguistics is that the sound of a word and its meaning are totally arbitrary.
Sure, a social convention.
Exactly. Odam Tili theory says, no, that's wrong. It argues language is biophysically grounded, rooted in how our bodies and senses work, that there's a natural coding.
Okay, hold on. Phonosemantics, the idea that sounds have inherent meaning, has been on the fringes of linguistics for a long time. Some would say it's pseudoscience. What's different here?
The math and the consistency. This is the part that just blows up the standard model. It provides empirical evidence that certain phonemes, specific sounds, act as dynamic polarity operators.
Polarity operators, what does that mean?
It means they function like multiplying by negative one in an equation. Sounds like K, P, N, and V, they aren't random. They actively generate contrast or opposition inside a word's root.
Wait, so you're saying a single sound can literally act like a minus sign? It can flip the meaning of a word from, say, compression to expansion.
That is precisely it. The sound structure itself is carrying a mathematical instruction.
That's profound. So for AI, this means we stop just counting word statistics and start processing these biophysical primitives directly.
Yes, and that's how you solve the semantically hollow problem. You move from just faking it with stats
Yeah.
to actually recreating the conditions for understanding, semantic embodiment.
So if you connect all the dots here.
The real future is the convergence of these two ideas. You get MIT's efficiency and mathematical certainty on one side, and Odam Tili's intrinsic meaning and human-aligned architecture on the other.
So the strategic imperative then becomes stop chasing volume.
Stop chasing volume. Quality of data is now all about its foundational relevance. Does this new data point help you define a geometric boundary or a biophysical one?
And any organization that gets this first will have a huge advantage, not just in cost, but in building systems you can actually trust.
It's a first mover advantage for sure.
All right, so let's leave everyone with a final thought to mull over. If the era of big data really has peaked, what does focusing on the deep structure of language and decisions mean for how we should approach learning and education itself?